When we read in Acts chapter 2, we begin to gain a keen understanding of the purpose of the church, which is to teach biblical doctrine, to glorify God through prayer and worship with other believers, and to be a lighthouse by actively serving and proclaiming the gospel message of Jesus Christ. For nearly 170 years, Upper Deer Creek Church has played a small yet pivotal role in this extraordinary plan that is being made known for God's eternal purpose, accomplished through Christ Jesus our Lord. It is only through a church that is truly believing and pursuing what God has established that we begin to see His miraculous work unfold. God has laid the foundation for our church. So join us as we continue to pursue the immeasurable love of God and to seek to be used to fulfill His purpose for Upper Deer Creek Church. To Him be the glory forever and ever.
Come have your way among us. keep worshiping this morning with a new song, and this song is called Graves into Gardens. And what I love about spring and about Easter is just the transformation that happens and that takes place as we see flowers start to bloom and the sun starting to shine and the weather starting to warm up. And in our own lives, in this current season that we're in, God can do some major transforming within each of us. And that is the hope of Easter, that we're not left where we are, that we have a hope and we can trust Him to just move in our hearts and to change us. And so I hope the words to this song bless you today. He is the God of change, and He is the only one who can change us in our hearts and make that change that's everlasting. So I hope these words bless you today.
Better.
Song going around online, and it's called The Blessing, and it was recently written by Carrie Jobe and Elevation Worship. And it's a song that, as I sing it this morning, I mean, I want to encourage you to sing along with me, but I also want to encourage you to just receive the blessing. And they have taken the scriptures out of Numbers that the Lord bless you and keep you and make his face to shine upon you and give you peace. And they've set scripture to music. And I just love when we can just sing the word. And I think that there's just so much power in that. And so this morning, right now in your homes, I want to encourage you just to be in a position to receive the blessing that God would have for you today.
Bless you and
upon you and a thousand generations, and your family and your children and their children and their children. May his favor be upon you and a thousand generations, and your family and your children and their children and their children. May his presence go before you and behind you and beside you, all around you and within you. He is with you, he is with you. May his presence go before you and behind you and beside you, all around you and within you. He is with you, he is with you. In the morning, in the evening, in your coming and your going, in your weeping and rejoicing, God, we thank you that you are for us, that right now you are with us. God, we thank you for surrounding us. God, right now we just receive your blessing. We thank you for your hand over each and every person that's watching right now, God, and that you see us, that you have turned your face toward us. And God, we just want to receive your peace today. Lord, we love you and we thank you in Jesus' name. Everyone said amen.
We're definitely glad that you're worshiping with us this morning, and just a fabulous song that Abby just led us into, and just the blessing of God. And I love scripture being sang, and we talked about that this week, just being able to sing scripture and what that really means. Well, let me ask you a question. And start off every time just asking you a question. Have you ever had to endure something? If you ever had to endure something, and you might say, I've had to endure school. I had to endure, golly, from kindergarten all the way through first year of master's, all in a row, 18 years. That was a lot of enduring school. Kids right now, I hear it every time. Kids come home as, we had to endure school. That's a tough thing. We think that we have to endure, we have to go through, we have to battle with it. We have to endure things like school. We endure things like a job. Sometimes we just don't like our job, and we have to endure it. We hate going to it. Every day we're like, I just have to make it through. I just have to endure another 8 hours, and then I'll make it home. I'm just having to endure because, you know what, I just don't like my coworkers. You know, I don't like my boss. I don't like the people
who I have to manage. I just have to endure my job. Or maybe you look and you think, you know what, every time that there is a holiday, you have to endure some family members. Everybody's got that one family member, don't you? You have that one family member that you have to endure. Now, some of you right now are looking at that family member in your house, whether they're sitting next to you or you're thinking about it. And here's the deal. If no one comes to mind that you have to endure, then you are probably the one that people are having to endure. But we all have that that crazy family member that we're just like, if we get there, we have to endure them. We have to endure their stories. We have to endure all of that with that family get together. You may have to endure a losing season. You're not used to losing. And you have to endure that. You have to go through it, and it's just rough, and it just drains you to have to endure one thing after another, a loss here, loss there, and it could weigh on you, whether it be a coach, whether it be a player. It's just that enduring part that you just struggle with. It just takes its toll on you. Then you might have to endure a sickness. You don't like to be sick, and that sickness just seems to be dragging on and dragging on, or you've had to see somebody go through an illness that really just was so hard. You just had to endure with them and to see them. Maybe you had to endure a bad meal. I don't know if you're a husband and when you first got married and your wife cooked, I don't know if she knew how to cook and you ate everything that was put in front of you. I did. When we first got married, Trina was learning to cook, and she cooked everything to perfection, okay? I didn't have to endure anything, okay? And so you think about this. We might have to endure a meal, something that, you know, Brad may cook, that jalapenos with peanut butter in them with bacon. You have to endure some of that stuff, even though, you know what, they're not half bad. They're really not. They're not half good, but they're not half bad. You have to endure some of that. Okay, but why do we endure? Why do people endure things? And this is why. I'm glad that you asked that question. Why do people endure things? Is because we are committed to what we are doing. I'm going to endure because I'm committed to finishing it. I'm committed to going through with it to the complete end. I am committed to go and finish this. So if I have to endure, I'm going to endure because I want to finish this. It's like all the kids right now at school, at home, they're having to endure not getting up early and going to school and sitting in classrooms, and they're having to endure that. You know, and we just look, because they want to finish school. They just don't want school to end. They want to finish. They want to endure that, and that's just completely not true. But we look at it, we just look at things. We want to finish our school. We want to finish this job. We want to see it complete to the end. We want to finish this season. We want to endure. We want to go through because we don't want to start something and it get tough and we just quit. We need to endure. Is it easy to endure? Is it easy to endure? The answer to that is no. Let me give you the dictionary definition of the word endure. This is what it says. To remain firm under suffering or misfortune without yielding. To undergo especially without giving in or to suffer. To endure something is not for the faint of heart. Okay? To endure something is not for the faint of heart. We're going through a time right now where we're having to be, you know, quarantine, stay in our homes with this coronavirus, and I'm an extrovert, and so for me to have to be at home a lot, you know, that's just not me. I like to be around people, and there's just so long that you can be around your family members without thinking bad thoughts in your mind. Like, I wonder if I locked them outside for 2 days, would they go somewhere else? I'm not sure. But, you know, being an extrovert, I'm having to endure not seeing your face here on a Sunday morning, sitting in these pews, because I like your faces. I know JC, I understand. I do like your face, okay? But we have to endure this time, and it's not easy. It's not easy. And it's not for the faint of heart. Because a lot of times when people get pressured, they just give up. We don't want to have to endure what it takes to finish what we're called to do. Okay? You know, the last 3 weeks, we've been looking at this word behind me, and you've seen it. It's called love. That word is love, L-O-V-E. We looked the first week at the L meaning loyalty and how Jesus was loyal to us, how he was loyal to God. We looked at the O meaning obey and how Jesus obeyed God, okay? He obeyed him because that was his heart. That was his love for us, was his obedience to God. We looked at the V this last week. And the V was for victory and how Jesus was victorious. He was victorious over sin, over death, the grave. He was victorious. Why? For you and for me. And then we get to the E. The E, and if you haven't already figured it out, the E we're going to look at today is for the word endure and what Jesus had to endure for our sake. And he did. And Jesus endured from his first breath to his last breath. He endured this short life that he lived for us. Why? Because he loved us with an immeasurable love. And we're going to look at today at what are some of the things that Jesus had to endure. We're going to look at some of these things and the results of his endurance. So Jesus had to, and I mentioned a second ago, he had to endure from birth unto death. And so if you know scripture and you know when he was born, there was a decision to try and kill him from his first breath. They didn't want him living because they knew who he was going to be. And I'm just thinking about that is that's none of us have had to endure something like that from our very first breath. But Jesus had to endure that. And as you keep looking, he had to endure when he was young, he had to endure his parents not understanding some of really who he was when he was teaching in the synagogues and they left him. And I don't know if it was some of my kids, I might would just say, well, surely they can find their way home. But I look at this and Jesus had to endure his parents not fully grasping who he was. And at those moments as he was growing up, you know, I just kind of wonder what he thought, what he had to endure when having conversations with his parents. He had to endure when he stepped into ministry. He had to endure Satan tempting him in the wilderness. He had to endure that. You know, it's not easy. As far as Jesus was there for 40 days and what he had to endure, a lot of us, I don't know that we would endure that. If we were offered promises the way Satan offered promises to Jesus, would we endure that constant barrage from Satan trying to get us not to be who God has created us to be? Jesus went through that. He had to endure that. And he had to endure, if you look at it, just so many things. And why did he choose to endure? Because he, as it says back here, he loves us. He loves you sitting right there in your chair, laying in your bed, wrapped up in that blanket right now. He loves you. And that's why he endured for you. Okay, we're going to look at some scriptures today. And so hopefully you have your Bibles. If you don't, take one from the person next to you and they'll have to get up and go get one. Okay, so here's the deal. Jesus had to endure, and as he started his ministry and he was going through teaching, he had to endure religious leaders. He had to endure religious people. Now you may say, Mark, we have to endure religious people a lot. You know, that they will say things and do things. We just have to endure them. Well, we didn't have to endure them the way Jesus had to endure them. So if you have your Bibles, open them to probably the greatest book ever written, and that's the book of Mark, okay? Mark chapter 8, all right? Mark chapter 8, I had my Bible opened to it a minute ago, and then I moved it. I'm going to blame my children for that. Mark chapter 8, starting in verse 11, okay? Mark chapter 8, starting in verse 11. This is Jesus having to endure from religious people, okay? Now, Jesus had just fed in the book of Mark here. He just fed 4,000. Just performed an incredible miracle. And then we see that in the first 10 verses. Then we see in verse 11. The Pharisees came and began to question Jesus. To test him, they asked him for a sign from heaven. He sighed deeply and said, "Why does this generation ask for miracles? I tell you the truth, no sign will be given to it." Then he left them, got back in the boat, and crossed to the other side. These people had just seen a miracle in the feeding of these thousands of people. Yet they came to Jesus and said, "We want to test you. We need more proof that you are who you say you are. So give us a sign. Give us a sign." You think, why is that enduring? Have you ever had somebody just look at you and not believe? They just didn't believe what you just said. You just proved it in front of them, and they're like, "No, we need more." Jesus had to endure this type of thing throughout his ministry, dealing with Pharisees, dealing with religious people. He had to endure their questions. He had to endure what they were just trying to throw at him and to test him and trying to trip him up. Look at Matthew chapter 22. Matthew 22, starting in verse 15, says this. Matthew chapter 22, starting in verse 15. This is Jesus dealing with Pharisees here. This is what it says. Matthew 22, starting in verse 15. Then the Pharisees went out and laid plans to trap him in his words. They sent their disciples to him along with the Herodians. "Teacher," they said, "we know that you are a man of integrity and that you teach the way of God in accordance with truth. You aren't swayed by men because you pay no attention to who they are. Tell us then, what is your opinion? Is it right to pay taxes to Caesar or not?" But Jesus, knowing their evil intent, said, "You hypocrites, why are you trying to trap me? Show me the coin used for paying the tax." They brought him a denarius, and he asked them, "Whose portrait is this, and whose inscription?" "Caesar's," they replied. Then he said to them, "Give to Caesar what is Caesar's, and to God what is God's." When they heard this, they were amazed, so they left him and went away. This is something Jesus had to endure constantly from religious people. He had to endure them trying to trap him, trying to get him to mess up, try to say something he shouldn't say. And they were very, very plain and very simple here. They wanted him to do something that they could say, "God, this is definitive. You are not this Messiah. You are not who you say you are." They were in constant mode to trap him. And he had to endure that. Almost everywhere he went, he had to endure from religious people. We see in Luke chapter 19. Luke chapter 19, starting in verse 28, says this. Luke 19, starting in verse 28. You know, we look at this triumphal entry of Jesus coming, and he's approaching Jerusalem. This is triumphal entry. We see in Luke 19, starting in verse 28, we see him telling his disciples, "Hey, go find me this, go do this. Here's the instructions that he gives. We need to do all this." And so they do it, and he starts to walk in, and you see the rows of people on each side, and they're singing these songs, saying these things in loud voices. You know, in verse 37, when they came near the place where the road goes down to the Mount of Olives, the whole crowd of disciples began joyfully to praise God in loud voices for all the miracles they had seen. "Blessed is the King who comes in the name of the Lord. Peace in heaven and glory in the highest." And listen to this in verse 39. Some of the Pharisees said in the crowd to Jesus, "Teacher, rebuke your disciples." And Jesus says, "I tell you," he replied, "if they keep quiet, the stones will cry out. So as he approached Jerusalem and saw the city, he wept over it and said, if you, even you, had only known on this day what would bring you peace, but now it is hidden from your eyes. The days will come upon you when your enemies will build an embankment against you and encircle you and hem you in on every side, and they will dash you to the ground, you and your children within these walls. They will not leave one stone on another because you did not recognize the time of God's coming. They were questioning Jesus' leadership. They're like, Jesus, hey, listen, you need to tell your disciples to be quiet. They don't need to be praising you like this. They don't need to be doing this. Jesus, walking into Jerusalem, knowing what was about to happen, had to continue to endure from religious people their taunts, their questions, their accusations all the time. And in John chapter 12, 37 through 42, people were scared to truly come out and say, this is who we are. We love Jesus Christ. We want to follow him. They were scared because it says that they were scared due to the threat of the Pharisees. So constantly, Jesus was having to endure religious people, trying to share his heart, his love with people, and he had to endure this. It wasn't a one-time thing. To endure is a constant state. It's not just a endure and I'm done. To endure is a constant thing. Jesus had to. He had to endure this. For a lot of us, we'd have just said, listen, just quit. I'm done. If you're going to continue to harass me, if you're going to continue to question me, if you're going to continue to say these things and accuse me, I'm done. I'm walking away. You're not worth it. But fortunately, we have a God. We have a Jesus that loved us to that extent that he said, I will endure from religious people. He endured them. He endured these religious people. Understand, he endured them because he loved them. He did. He loved them. Even when they did not love him, he loved them and had to endure all of that. All of these people Jesus went and endured because he absolutely loved their hearts. We think sometimes, well, that, you know, is that really enduring? If you had to go through what Jesus did, he had to endure all of that for years. He had to endure that. Not only did Jesus have to endure from religious people, he had to endure his own disciples. A lot of times we don't think about that. He had to endure from his own disciples their unbelief, their lack of understanding. In Matthew chapter 16 says this in verse 21. Matthew 16, starting in verse 21. This is Jesus predicting his death, okay? He's predicting his death. This is what it says, Matthew chapter 16, starting in verse 21. From that time on, Jesus began to explain to his disciples that he must go to Jerusalem and suffer many things at the hands of the elders, the chief priests, the teachers of the law, the religious people, and that he must be killed and on the third day raised to life. Well, Peter took him aside and began to rebuke him. Never, Lord, he said, this shall never happen to you. And Jesus turned to Peter and said, you know, very lovingly, very gently, Get behind me, Satan. You are a stumbling block to me. You do not have in mind the things of God, but the things of men. Then Jesus said to his disciples, if anyone would come after me, he must deny himself, take up his cross and follow me. For whoever wants to save his life will lose it, but whoever loses his life for me will find it. What good will it be for a man if he gains the whole world yet forfeits his soul? Or what can a man give in exchange for his soul? For the Son of Man is going to come in his Father's glory with his angels. Then he will reward each person according to what he has done. And I tell you the truth, some who are standing here will not taste death before they see the Son of Man coming in his kingdom. Even his disciples that walked with him, that ate with him, that lived with him, they breathed the same air right next to him. They did everything with Jesus, and even then, they didn't get it. And I think, how often is it for us when we have to endure somebody that just doesn't get it? And you teach them, and they walk with you, and you show them, and you just really in front of them give them that example, and they just can't grasp it. And we have to endure that. These guys that walked with Jesus, he had to endure that. And here's the deal, he never gave up on them. He never gave up on them. You see, in Matthew chapter 17, one chapter over, in verse 14, this healing of a boy with a demon. When they came to the crowd, a man approached Jesus and knelt before him. "Lord, have mercy on my son," he said. "He has seizures and is suffering greatly. He often falls into the fire or into the water. I brought him to your disciples, but they could not heal him." And Jesus says this in verse 17, "O unbelieving and perverse generation," Jesus replied, "how long shall I stay with you? How long shall I put up with you? Bring the boy here to me." So Jesus rebuked the demon. It came out of the boy, and he was healed from that moment. Then the disciples came to Jesus in private and asked, "Why couldn't we drive this demon out?" Jesus replied, "Because you have so little faith. I tell you the truth, if you have faith as small as a mustard seed," if you have the faith of a flea, that size, okay, this mustard seed, you can come and say to this mountain, "Move from here to there," and it will move. Nothing will be impossible for you. So when they came together in Galilee, he said to them, "The Son of Man is going to be betrayed into the hands of men. They will kill him, and on the third day he will be raised to life." And the disciples were filled with grief. So Jesus, looking at his disciples, had to continue to endure their lack of faith. He had to continue to endure. They're just not getting it. They're not believing it. And he had to all the time answer their questions. Why can't we do this? Because you don't have faith. You have little faith. And again, this is the second time in a row where he spoke to them and told them, "Listen, when we go in here, I'm going to be arrested. I'm going to be tortured. I'm going to be crucified. And on the third day, I'm going to be raised again." And so, as he spoke these things, he would, as it says, be delivered up to the chief priests and the scribes. That's the first thing he said that was going to happen. The second thing, he was going to be condemned to death. The third thing, he was going to be delivered to the Gentiles and mocked. The fourth thing, he was going to be scorned. And the fifth thing, he was going to be crucified. He laid those things out. And the sixth thing was going to be raised on the third day. So he laid these things out. He told them this was what's going to happen. And after the disciples arrived in Jerusalem with Jesus, they saw Jesus accomplish. And all of these things that happened, these first five things, they saw every single one of them come to pass. They saw Jesus arrested. They saw him condemned. They saw him beaten. They saw him scorned. They saw him crucified. And so I wonder, sometimes I wonder how much he endured from his disciples from the standpoint that they saw everything that Jesus did leading up to this point, leading up to him being crucified. They saw all of that. Yet for some reason, they didn't believe that he was probably going to be raised from the dead. And Jesus, knowing that, he had to endure his closest friends, their disbelief, after he had shown them and lived it in front of them, and they had seen the truth in who Jesus was, they still wouldn't believe. And Jesus had to endure that, not from religious leaders only, but from his closest friends, his disciples. Jesus simply had to be frustrated. Just had to be frustrated. And he had to endure this with these guys that he taught and he poured his life and his heart into. He had to endure that. So we see that Jesus endured these religious leaders. He endured his own disciples. Why? Because he loved them. Because he wanted their hearts. And then we see how Jesus had to endure physically. Okay, Matthew chapter 27, we see all of that where Jesus had to stand before Pilate. He was brought about in a fake trial. These soldiers were there. We see that Jesus was arrested. We see that he was paraded through the streets as a criminal. And just how really embarrassing that is. Now, physically, can you imagine what he had to go through? I'm sure people were hurling things at him. So he was paraded through the streets as a criminal. He was flogged. He was beaten. And we see all of that in Matthew chapter 27. Just the physical toll that went through Jesus' body. He was stripped down. He was spit on. Maybe the worst degrading thing that could ever happen is to be spit on. Jesus had to endure that. He was had a crown of thorns put on him. He was made to carry his cross through the streets. All the while, I'm sure that he was whipped for going too slow, for not being the strong Messiah, just beaten on. They nailed him to a cross. They stuck a sword in his side, and I just think physically the torture, the physical anguish that he had to go through. And I look and I think this crown of thorns, and what did that represent? What did that feel like? This enduring that type of pain. And so I had the opportunity to go out to the Zex and get a crown of some thorns and make a crown of thorns. And so Delaney drove and Marin was there and had to endure that. But I put together a crown of thorns yesterday of kind of what I thought maybe Jesus had to wear. And I look at this and I think of this crown of thorns and what, just to, I don't know if you can really see this crown and these thorns. They're, you know, 3 inches long on some of them. And I think just to have this set on top of your head and push down, and what that would be physically, and Jesus had to endure that. I don't even want to imagine what he endured physically for you and for me. You know, this great love that Jesus had for us compelled him to endure, drove him to continue to finish out God's purpose for him. We see that in Matthew 27. We see in 1 Peter chapter 2, verses 23 and 24, where it says, when they hurled their insults at him, he did not retaliate. When he suffered, he made no threats. Instead, he entrusted himself to the one who judges justly. He himself bore our sins in his body on a tree, so that we might die to sins and live for righteousness. For by his wounds we are healed. For by his wounds, by his physical torture, this what he endured for us, by that we are healed. Our hearts are healed. We're freed from sin because of what he endured physically. We see in Hebrews chapter 12, if you have your Bibles, flip over there. Hebrews chapter 12, starting in verse 2 and 3, says this. Hebrews chapter 12, 2 and 3. Let us fix our eyes on Jesus, the author and perfecter of our faith, who for the joy set before him endured the cross, scorning its shame, and sat down at the right hand of the throne of God. Consider him who endured such opposition from sinful men, so that you will not grow weary and lose heart. For the joy set before him, he endured the cross. How could Jesus look at the cross and see joy? How could he endure something of that for pure joy? His joy came in knowing that what he was about to do was going to bring us freedom. What he was about to do was going to enable us to be in a relationship with God. For the joy set before him, he endured the cross. Why? Why? Because he loves you. That's why. It's very plain, very simple. All that he endured was for our sake. For our sake, for our redemption, for our heart. He endured the cross. He endured the physical pain. All of that was for us, for our heart, for our redemption, for us to be in a relationship with God, for us to spend eternity with God in heaven. If we trust our hearts with him, he had the joy of that is what he saw in the cross. And so he endured that because he was going to finish what God had purposed in his life to finish. The joy set before him in the cross. The physical part of this endurance, where a lot of us would have given up, Jesus completed the cross. He endured it. He endured the cross for selfish people. He endured the cross for people who didn't love him, people didn't like him. He endured the cross for the people that wanted to kill him. He endured the cross for people who didn't want to listen. He endured the cross for people who would not accept who he was, all because he was fulfilling the plan that God had laid out for him, this plan of redemption that God had desired for us to experience. He endured the cross. He endured physically for us. I don't believe that there is a better definition of the word love than what we see in Scripture. This act of love, this act of enduring, Jesus showed that to us, and he showed that to you. You know, I look and what Jesus went through, what he endured, he did it because you're worth it. He did it because you are his treasure. You are his joy. That's why he endured religious people, endured the unbelief, the lack of faith from even his own followers. That's why he endured the physical torment that he went through. He endured it because he wanted to win your heart. He wanted to provide a way for you to know God. You may be sitting there this morning where you're at in your home, and you don't know Jesus Christ today. You've never trusted him as your personal Lord and Savior, the lover of your soul. And today, I want to invite you to do that. Today, as we've looked through what he endured for you because he loved you, maybe today God is stirring your heart. Maybe he's speaking to your heart, saying, trust me, trust me. I set this plan. My purpose in Jesus was fulfilled. Trust me, I want your heart. And maybe today, maybe it's time. Maybe it's time for you to give Jesus your heart. Full-fledged, nothing holding you back. Maybe today where you're at, you just simply need to say, Jesus, I want you to come into my heart to be my personal Lord and Savior, the lover of my soul, the leader of my life, my decision maker, my way maker. Maybe today that's what Jesus needs to do for you. Maybe you're at that point of just saying, God, forgive me of my sin. Forgive me of what I've done in my life that has been dishonoring to you. Forgive me of that. Cleanse me of that. And I want to trust my heart and my life with you. It's as simple as saying those words, praying those words to God for Jesus to come in and enter into your heart. And it may be today that that's where you're at. Maybe right now you just need to simply pray that prayer. of asking Jesus to come into your heart. I had the opportunity to lead a seventh grade boy to Christ one day, and he simply said this, I don't know what to pray. I just want Jesus. And I think that God knew at that moment that that boy opened his heart and Jesus came in, because your heart is going to share a lot. And so this morning, where you're at, I want to encourage you. I want to encourage you right now. If you don't know Jesus, trust your heart with him. Pray that prayer in your own words, just to give your heart to him. Maybe you have an adult right there with you, a parent, grandparent, a brother, sister, who are believers, and they can share with you right now how to come to know Christ. Let's do it. Right now, where you're at, if this is something God has laid on your heart, pray that prayer. I would love to talk with you about it. If that's something that God is just really speaking to your heart about, get a hold of me. Talk to me. I would love to sit down and share with you the greatness of knowing Christ. And so today, as we end this morning, I don't want you to be done with this service not knowing who Jesus Christ is, what he endured for you, because he simply loves you more than anything. So today, if that's what God's telling you to do, pray that. Seek his heart today and see the change that God is going to do in your life that is going to be life-changing, eternity-changing. So as we close, I'm just going to pray for you. I just want you to join with me in praying and just seeking God's heart and thanking him for enduring what he endured, because we were the joy set before him. Pray with me. God, we just come to you today thanking you for who you are, thanking you for enduring all that you endured for us, for wanting us to be yours. And so, God, I pray that if there's somebody watching here this morning, God, I pray that you would just capture their heart. God, you know their heart's condition. You know if you've been speaking to them, if they're ready to respond to you. And I pray, God, that today they would do that. So, Lord, I pray that you would just surround those homes. God, that you would do something amazing in them. And Jesus, thank you for looking at us and seeing us as your joy, as a treasure of your heart, and worth dying for. So God, we thank you for fulfilling your purpose and your plan in our redemption. And Jesus, thank you again for enduring what you did because you loved us. So God, we just want to surrender our hearts to you this morning. May you do something great in our lives, and we are just going to ever give you the praise and the glory due your name. And it's in the only name worth praying to, Jesus Christ. Amen. Hey, we are glad that you are here this morning worshiping with us. And so we just want to encourage you to have a great week. This next week is Easter. We want to encourage you to be excited about Easter. Just because we're not having church doesn't mean Jesus didn't raise from the dead. So we want to encourage you to be excited about next week, Easter, and tuning in as we get to share Christ with you next week. Also, we're going to be doing a sunrise service on Facebook Live at 7 a.m. It's going to be awesome, just like last year. We're going to do it outside. We're going to see the sun come up. It's going to be a great time. We want to encourage you just to come in, be a part of that, just enjoy that time with us this next Sunday morning.